Hello friends, welcome once again to my channel Prosto Hub. So in today's session we'll be discussing another philosophy of full mouth rehabilitation, which is the second most popular one after Fankim and Schuller, and that's the hobo philosophy. It consists of two parts. Earlier they developed the technique that is twin tables technique, which was proposed by Japanese dentist Dr. Sumiya Hobo, and later on the advanced stage, that is a twin stage procedure by Hobo and Takayama. So before beginning, I request everyone to please do like, share and subscribe to my channel if you are finding these videos useful. If you have any suggestion or if you want any topic in particular, please do write it in the comment section and I'll try to do a video on that. So let's begin. So in the previous sessions of philosophies in full mouth rehabilitation, we have discussed the first and foremost philosophy, that was the nephrological concept by McCallum, Stuart and Stallard. If you want to refer to it, please do watch the session 5. So in that concept, they focused primarily on the condyla path, and it was believed that anterior guidance was independent of the condyla path. But it had several limitations, like there was discrepancy between centric relation and centric occlusion, and also they need precise restoration. So the need for a fully adjustable articulator was a must. And the provisional restorations were given in cast metal, which were of very high cost and was very difficult to equilibrate. So later on, Hobo and Takayama did several studies and revealed that the anterior guidance influenced the working condyla path, and they were not independent factors, but they were dependent factors. And based on that, Hobo adopted the concept of posterior disocclusion, and he gave the twin tables technique. So I have referred the below articles of Hobo in order to make this PPT. The twin stage procedure was considered to be an advanced version of twin table technique. So Takayama and Hobo in their research studies concluded that cusp angle was found to be the most reliable determinant of occlusion because it does not deviate and was found to be 4 times reliable than condylar and the incisal path. So this was the twin stage procedure, which we'll be discussing in our coming session. So in today's session, we'll be discussing in detail about the twin tables technique. So before that, let us see the importance of anterior guidance. So we have discussed the anterior guidance and harmonization of anterior guidance, I think, in our session 4. So this is defined as the dynamic relation of the lower anterior teeth against the upper anterior teeth through all the ranges of function. And it ranges from 2 to 6 millimeter, which greatly influences occlusion. And the anterior guidance should always be steeper than the condylar path, at least 5 degree approx. And when the patient protrudes the mandible, it is the anterior teeth which guides the mandible into a downward path, creating space between the posterior teeth, which is referred to as posterior disocclusion. So about posterior disclusion and all other occlusal consideration, we have discussed it as a separate session. Please do watch it for further details. Now, this posterior disocclusion also happens during the lateral movement by the same phenomenon. So this is the importance of anterior guidance. You can expect this as a viva question also. What is the purpose of anterior guidance? So the purpose is mainly to protect the teeth from the harmful effects of cuspal interferences. Like, they protect the posterior teeth because as the mandible moves, it is the anterior guidance that guide the mandible downward. So creating a space between posterior teeth and thereby preventing cuspal interferences. Now coming to the determinants of disclusion. So there are 3 important determinants. One is the condylar path, the incisal path and the cusp angle. As you can see in the picture, cusp angle is the angle that is made by the average slope of the cusp to that of the cuspal plane. So this is the cusp angle. Next is the mechanism of disocclusion. So Hobo and Takayama conducted different studies and found out that there are 4 mechanisms by which disclusion can happen, and they also measured the amount of disclusion and found it to be an average of 1.06 mm during the protrusion and also a 1 mm on the non-working side and 0.4 mm on the working side during lateral movement. So let us see the mechanism one. As you can see here, the incisal path, the condylar path and the cusp angle, all three are parallel to each other. So in situation where it happens like this, the mandible translates without any disclusion and there is only sliding movement. So this is a case of balanced occlusion, where there is no disclusion and contact is there everywhere. So let us see the mechanism two, where the incisal path is steeper than that of the condylar path and the cusp elongation. So these two are parallel to each other, whereas the incisal path is much steeper. So in such cases, the mandible translates and rotates around the condylar axis, and also it creates a posterior disclusion. So posterior disclusion was measured to be around 0.2 millimeter, which was only 1/5 of the standard value. So the component of disocclusion which occurs when the anterior guidance is steeper than that of the condylar guidance and the cuspal inclination was termed as the anterior guide component. So that is the anterior guide component, which is the component of disclusion that happens when the incisal path is steeper. And what is angle of hinge rotation? It is the rotation of the mandible that occurs when there is a difference in inclination. So that is angle of hinge rotation. So there are two terminologies. One is anterior guide component and another one is angle of hinge rotation. So this is basically the mechanism two. Now coming to the mechanism three, here you can see the anterior guidance and the condylar guidance are parallel to each other, but the cuspal angle is much shallower. So in such situations, the mandible translates without rotation, but there is posterior disocclusion. So this shows you how important is the cusp angle factor. So when the cusp angle factor is shallow and the anterior guidance and the condylar guidance are parallel to each other, what happens is that there is posterior disocclusion. So the component of disocclusion that happens when the condylar path, or sorry, when the cusp angle is shallower, that is called as the cusp shape component. So the twin tables technique was developed in such a way that to accommodate both the cusp shape component and the angle of hinge rotation. This is the last mechanism which is seen in healthy individuals, that is mechanism 4. And here you can see that the incisal path is steeper, the cusp angle is shallower. So in such situation, again the mandible translates, rotates, and also there is posterior disclusion, which is a standard value 1.06 millimeter. And this is seen in healthy individuals. So these were the four mechanisms. Now coming to another terminology called buffer spacing. So in their studies, they found that, Hobo and Takayama found that the condylar path of individuals used to deviate. That is the deviation they measured to be 0.8 mm on the protrusion, 0.8 mm on the non-working lateral condylar path and 0.3 mm maximum on the working side condylar path. So they measured this condylar path using electronic measuring system and found these measurements. So why this deviation is happening? So according to Hobo and Takayama, this deviation in this condylar path is termed as the buffer space. And this buffer space exists in the glenoid fossa, and it is a mechanism to protect the application of direct stresses onto the TMJ. That means it allows condylar mobility and it prevents the transmission of direct stresses onto the articular disc, thereby preventing problems like disc displacement, disc perforation, etc. So buffer space was found to be essential in order to protect the TMJ. Now let us see in detail about the twin table technique. So as the name indicates, there are two incisal guide table in this twin table. So the first incisal guide table is called as incisal table without disocclusion, and that is to accommodate the cusp shape factor. And the second incisal table, that is the incisal guide table with disclusion, in order to accommodate angle of hinge rotation. So we are fabricating two incisal guide table, the first incisal guide table without disclusion and the second one with disclusion. So this is called as a twin table technique. Okay, so now let us see in detail what this is. So first of all, diagnostic casts are mounted on an Archon type semi-adjustable articulator with box type fossa. This is in order to mimic the working condylar path. Now these casts are mounted using the face bow record and the centric relation record. The maxillary cast is made in such a way that the anterior portion of the maxillary cast is removable by using double pins. Now what is the use of making this removable? So we have said that it is the anterior teeth which creates posterior disocclusion. So in instances where we need to create or we need to wax the occlusal morphology of the posterior teeth, the anterior guidance will become an obstacle. So in order to remove this, so we remove this anterior segment so that we can do the posterior morphology without the obstacle of anterior guidance. Now next step is removal of posterior interferences. For this, carbon occlusal paper is placed between maxillary and mandibular posterior teeth on either side and articulator is moved to simulate forward, right and left movements. So these markings are seen and wherever interference is there, it is removed. And wherever the teeth is deficient in contact, you have to add the wax until it makes even contact. So the upper and the lower teeth smoothly glide during maximum intercuspation. So the posterior interferences are removed and also wherever there was deficient tooth structure, it is built up to create even contact. Now the incisal table is being applied with chemically cured acrylic resin. And this resin is molded by making the articulator move in all excursive movement. So thus we get the incisal table without disclusion, and this incisal table will three-dimensionally coincide with our condylar path as well as the cusp angle. So these cusp angle and condylar path will be parallel to each other. And now if you make the anterior guidance according to this this incisal guide table, that is incisal guide table without disclusion, you will get balanced occlusion. So this is the incisal guide table without disclusion. Hope you have understood. So we make two incisal guide table without disclusion. So one is used for fabrication of our final restoration and another one we modify it to form incisal table with disclusion. So the first step of incisal table without disclusion is over and the next one is incisal table with disclusion. For this, we make use of plastic indices. So these plastic indices are inserted into the right and the left condyles of the articulator. So when you insert these into the fossa boxes on the articulator, it will simulate the articulator automatically into a 3 millimeter protrusive position. The thickness of the plastic indices is 3 millimeter. So it will bring the articulator into a 3 millimeter protrusive position. And in order to simulate lateral excursion, you have to insert the plastic indices on either of the condyle. So that will bring the articulator into the lateral excursive position. So here first, let us insert this into both the sides, that is both the condyles, and that will bring the articulator into a 3 millimeter protrusive position. Now, in order to create the posterior disocclusion, so we know that the average value of disclusion is 1.1 millimeter. So we have to take a vinyl sheet of 1.1 millimeter thickness, and this is placed on the tip of the mesiobuccal cusp of mandibular first molar on the left as well as the right side. So this is the 1.1 millimeter thickness vinyl sheet that is placed. Now when you do this, when you insert the plastic indices and place the vinyl sheet, the incisal pin will be lifted upward as well as backward. So here I don't have the picture of the incisal pin that is shifted backward. Here actually it is showing the incisal pin shifted laterally, But instead of this position, it will be around here. Okay. Now, the gap that is present between the incisal pole as well as the incisal guide table is filled with an acrylic resin cone using a brush. So, this acrylic resin cone indicates the position of the incisal pole at a 3 mm protrusive position and also with 1.1 mm of posterior disocclusion. So, this will also create the angle of hinge rotation, that is the rotation of the mandible due to the difference in inclination. Okay, so this is the placement of resin cone. Now, while placing the resin cone, you have to be careful that it has to be placed towards the outer edge of this pathway and always to the back side of the incisal pole. What happens if you place it in the front is that during excursion, the incisal pin can crush the resin cone. So, always remember it should be placed on the back side of the incisal pin. So, this is the ideal position. Now, you have to simulate the lateral moment. So, for this 3 mm thick plastic spacer is placed on the non-working side fossa box in order to approximate the lateral moment. And for disclusion, we know that on the working side it should be 1 mm, non-working side it should be 0.5 mm. So, corresponding to that, thickness vinyl sheet is taken and placed on both the non-working side and on the working side, that is on the mesiobuccal cusp of the molar. Now, you know that it has created the disocclusion and this is the position of the incisal pin during lateral excursion. So, here the incisal pin is directed laterally and upward. So, similarly on the other side also, we have to create this resin cone. So, finally, we get the incisal guide table with three resin cones. So, one is the protrusive and the other one indicating the lateral excursion. Now, we have to join these three resin cones using self-cure acrylic resin again. So, this will give you a triangular space if you join all the three resin cones. And into this triangular space, we again add self-cure acrylic resin and you make the articulator move in all excursion. So, these excursive movements will be recorded in this self-cure resin. So, this is the incisal guide table with posterior disocclusion. So, we have made the incisal table without disocclusion and incisal guide table with disocclusion. Now, see how we are going to fabricate the restorations. So, after the tooth preparation is completed, we mount the upper and the lower master cast onto the articulator using face bow and centric relation record. And then, you have to remove the maxillary cast anterior segment like I said before. So, this is to prevent the anterior guidance acting as an obstacle while making the occlusal morphology of the posterior teeth. So, once this is done, you can complete the posterior wax up. So, the condylar path as well as the disocclusion act as a guide for even gliding contacts in the posterior occlusal wax up. Now, once the posterior occlusal wax up is completed, you can place the incisal table with disclusion. Okay, and along with this, you can place the anterior segment back into position. Now, melted wax is applied on the lingual surface of the maxillary anteriors and you have to make the articulator move in all excursions. So, this will record the anterior guidance and this anterior guidance will be in harmony with the condylar path. Now, you have established anterior guidance in harmony with condylar path and also with predetermined posterior disocclusion. So, finally, we get restorations with incorporated predetermined disclusion on the articulator and also the anterior guidance that is in harmony with the condylar path. So, this is the procedure as a whole, the twin table technique. So, let us have a recap once again, the twin table technique. So, first study cast with removable anterior segment. As you can see here, this is the maxillary cast with removable anterior segment using dowel pins. And then it is mounted onto articulator using the face bow record as well as the centralization record. And check for posterior interferences. And also if there is any deficient tooth structure, you can add the wax until there is an even contact. So this procedure will result in the cusp shape factor, that is a proper cusp shape of the posteriors, and that will be in harmony with our condyla path. Okay. And then we have already said that is the addition of wax wherever it is deficient. Okay. So that finally we will get the maxillary and the mandibular teeth moving smoothly or having a smooth gliding motion in maximum intercuspation. Okay. So once this procedure is completed, this means that the cusp is now parallel to the condyla path. That is, the cusp shape factor has been harmoniously incorporated. Now the incisal table without disocclusion is fabricated. As I have said, a flat incisal table is used, chemically cured acrylic resin molded by moving the incisal pin through the eccentric movement. So this is the incisal guide table without disocclusion. So this is the incisal table without disocclusion, and we have to fabricate two of them. One you have to make for final restoration, and one you have to make use to modify it into incisal table with disocclusion. Okay. And if anterior guidance is organized according to the incisal table without disocclusion, you will get a fully balanced occlusion. So let us see, this is the plastic indices, that is 3 mm plastic indices that is placed into the fossa box. And this will simulate the articulator into protrusive as well as lateral excursive movement. Sheet is also placed, as you can see in this picture, the vinyl sheet. So here it is 0.5 mm, here it is 1 mm vinyl sheet is placed to create posterior disocclusion. So once it's done, the 3 mm spacer is placed behind the right as well as the left condyle to stimulate the protrusive movement, that is 3 mm protrusive position. And again, here you have the picture of the incisal pin that is shifted backward and upward. And again, a resin cone is placed there. So here you get the 3 resin cones. And this is joined by again using the resin. And the space is filled and again molded to get the incisal table with disclusion. Okay. So this is the incisal table with disclusion. Now the tooth preparation has been completed. And final impressions are recorded with polyvinyl siloxane impression material with a 2 mm spacer. And here the impressions were poured into in type 4 die stone, and dye-lock tray was used. So you can see the splitting and ditching of the dye was done. And 2 coats of dye spacer was also applied here. Now you have to do the posterior wax up. And for this we have to use the incisal table without disclusion. This is in order to prevent the anterior guidance acting as an obstacle. Okay. So once the occlusal morphology of the posterior teeth is completed, we move on to the anterior segment. Now the incisal table with disclusion is placed, and reposition the anterior segment on the maxillary cusp, complete the anterior wax up and establish the anterior guidance. So once that is done, the metal try-in is completed. And this is the post-cementation view in centric occlusion, where there is uniform contact. And you can see the posterior disclusion on both the lateral position as well as in the protrusive position. So this is the pre-op view and the post-op view. So thank you all for watching my video. And here comes the end of our twin table technique. And in the next session, we'll be discussing the Hobo's twin stage technique. So friends, please do like, share it among your friends and subscribe to my channel. And if you have any suggestion or any topic that needs to be discussed, please do write it in the comment section, or you can mail me at this mail ID. Thank you all until we meet again.